welcome to Women's Footy Grand Final wrap-up, and what an incredible finale it was to the inaugural AFLW season. The Adelaide Crows in an absolute thriller over the Brisbane Lions on the Gold Coast. We'll bring you the result in a moment, and then we'll also take a look at the game and the season that was with our incredible lineup over the next hour that includes some of the biggest names in the game. Carlton's star defender, Brianna Davey, as well as Western Bulldogs star midfielder in Emma Kearney, and also we've got our gun news hound who's been with us every week in Ros Lanigan. Great to have you join us, and on our plush sofa, great to have the co-captain of the Melbourne Football Club, Nathan Jones, and also the captain of the Collingwood women's football team, Steph Chiocci. Welcome, team. Looking forward to your thoughts in a moment, but let's take a look at the result on the Gold Coast, and it was a 6-point win for the Adelaide Crows over the Lions in front of 15,500 fans at Metricon, which is a fantastic crowd. All right, we're going to take a look at the week in review for Maya, the Department of Stories. And Ros, the Adelaide Crows went into this match as favourites despite the game being held in Queensland.
And despite them having, you know, a season that had a couple of weeks towards the end of the season that weren't great, but they did go in as favourites. A lot of people thought they'd get the job done, and they did. It was an incredibly close game. It went right to the wire. But as we saw, the first premiership goes to the Crows.
Absolutely.
Steph, what do you think of the game?
Yeah, I thought it was hotly contested from the start, and despite Adelaide's dominance in terms of the inside 50s, Brisbane were able to hold on and, you know, give themselves a chance come to the final quarter, but not to be. And as you can see there, Adelaide were victorious.
Remarkable too, given that Adelaide were probably tipped to finish bottom four, I guess, at the start of the season. When they played that practice match against Fremantle before the season, they looked good, and I think a lot of people got a sense then that they were better than they'd sort of been considered to be, but they were great.
The Lions had some chances late in the game, didn't they, Steph?
Yeah, they sure did, and like I said just then, you know, those inside 50s, you've got to capitalise on them, and I think in the last quarter they were even in terms of those inside 50s, but weren't able to put it on the board, and as we can see here, Hildebrand kicks it in deep, and probably a talking point here is this holding the ball? Is that incorrect disposal? And that would have given Frederick Traube a shot on goal.
I would have thought if that's holding the ball.
I'd have paid the free kick.
Nathan, Erin Phillips was an absolute star. She's been all season.
Yeah, she was unbelievable. 28 disposals, 11 inside 50s, 7 tackles, 2 goals. It's just a complete performance, really. She's obviously just grown coming from, you know, a basketball background into an absolute star of the competition, and, you know, putting a performance, you know, as you'd expect from a captain on the big stage. You know, terrific, unbelievable, really.
You got to remember too that she was listed as a rookie player, which is a remarkable story. Obviously, she's got a heap of talent, and those transferable skills between basketball and football have obviously worked out for her.
And she's a new mum. Here she is with her twins.
Yeah, and funnily enough, there's a photo today floating around of her father with her and the Premiership Cup, so sort of following in the family footsteps there.
Yeah, well, we've also got, there's a fantastic story coming out of this, and the Crows have adopted You're the Voice by John Farnham, which was launched 31 years ago. So all but Erin Phillips was wasn't alive when the song was released. So let's take a look at them singing this after the win. Saying to everyone, not only the football world, but the sporting world in general, take a look at us. Like, we're not going to sit in silence. We're going to stand up, and we're going to let you know exactly who we are and what we're here for.
How good was Bec Goddard when she used the lyrics from that song in her post-game speech up on the dais? It was hilarious. Like, it really cracked up the crowd, and it was a really nice touch. She clearly planned it, and that was something that they'd used as a motivator all season, that it is rewriting the history books. This is new, and they've been a huge part of it.
Absolutely. Well, Bec Goddard, in fact, met up with Tom Rand, the Channel 9 reporter, right after the game. Here she is.
Thanks, Tiff. Well, I'm joined by the Premiership coach now, Bec Goddard. Bec, it was such an amazing performance out there today. Just talk us through it and how well the girls performed.
Oh, it was an amazing performance, and we had everything thrown at us, and I think in turn we threw everything at Brisbane. So it was just that kind of game. No one was ever really in control of it. You know, I know that we led for probably most of it, but at no stage did we ever feel comfortable that that's where the game was at. You know, their defence was unbelievable, and our defence was also unbelievable, and it was just a hard slog.
It was just so tense, wasn't it? Mm. It was back and forth, and what an advertisement for the game itself. I know you've spoken about first impressions and how much you wanted to, you know, have everyone talk about this. certainly left the right impression today.
Yeah, we wanted to give the first impression on our first game against GWS, and we certainly talked about leaving a lasting impression on the competition today. And, you know, we got the result, but also we've left a lasting impression.
And Johnny Farnham, you were quoting "You're the Voice" afterwards in your speech. It's a real theme. That's just talk us through that.
Yeah, after every win, we've sung the team song, but then we've also put "You're the Voice" by Johnny Farnham on, mostly because I love John Farnham and so does Aaron Phillips.
So do I.
So we've forced everyone in the group to learn the words. Even the young girls now know him. He's a legend. So and it was more about we are the voice for a whole new wave of female footballers now, and having the chance to turn the pages over of what, you know, what's been.
Well, you've certainly done that, and you've juggled it all as well while you have your job in the police force, which is such a hectic job as well. Has that been difficult?
Yeah, look, I took some leave off once the season commenced, and I go back to work in a couple of weeks. So it was difficult in the pre-season, but certainly, you know, it was a start. The AFLW, the first season, was always going to be a start. So it had to start somewhere, and one day it might be fully professional.
Bec, congratulations. You've got so much to be proud of. You've accomplished so much. Well done, and enjoy the win in the moment.
Thanks very much.
Bec Goddard there, Tiff. A sensational performance. Back to you.
Thank you so much, Tom. And certainly a different Bec Goddard from the last couple of weeks where she was pretty despondent, but looking fantastic. And although she wouldn't have really liked the time on rule that was brought in for the grand final.
Well, I think it was a great change that the AFL made in the lead up to the grand final. Of course, in the home and away rounds of AFLW, there has only been time on after goals and major injuries. On the weekend, they played it after behinds and out of bounds as well. I think it was the right decision, and I think it's a decision we'll see across the home and away season in the next year of the AFLW competition. Steph, I'm interested to hear as a player what your take on that is.
Yeah, it's interesting. I quite like the time on rule because it sort of eliminates that other tactic of time wasting. And, you know, coming from a Collingwood point of view, that game in Brisbane that we had, you know, we fell short and there was some time knocked off the clock due to some boundary throw-ins that were recalled. So there's 5-10 seconds that, you know, we could have penetrated the forward line. But on a positive note, I think the crowd size exceeded expectations of the AFL with 15,500 people there, which was more...
about Ted, possibly?
Yeah, and it was more than the Q Clash. Yeah. I think the Q Clash had 12,500 people at the game. So,
that's remarkable. Outstanding. Well, like, I don't think you can say too much about that. It's in southern Queensland. It's not at Brisbane. And 3,000 more people turned up for a women's football game than did for the Q Clash. You were really surprised by this, Jonesy, when we were talking before the show.
Yeah, I was. I think it's unbelievable, really. You know, I hope with the progression that eventually the girls get the chance to play at the G and the game really explodes in that regard. But, you know, to have that result first up, exceeding you know, the AFL's expectations significantly, not just having to you know, open the top deck of the Metricon and that to cater for the crowd. It's unbelievable, really.
Definitely some lessons to learn from there. Well, that was our week in review for Maya, the Department of Stories. Get on board social media. Women's Footy AFL will be back with more on the grand final wrap right after this. Welcome back to Women's Footy for Maya, the Department of Stories, and our comprehensive review of the grand final, which was fantastically kicked off by local musician Megan Washington, who grew up in Brisbane, born actually in Papua New Guinea, and she's an all-round muso. She plays a bit of jazz, a bit of alternate rock, and there she is. She also sang the national anthem. Nathan, what is it like when the national anthem's sung, the hair stands on the end?
Yeah, well, I think that's the best precursor for a game, really. I love it when that happens. Like I was saying before, you know, the Anzac Eve game for us is probably the best, and hairs on the neck, and obviously the crowd really erupts at the end of it, and it gets the blood going. And
how many hairs do you have on your neck?
Not much.
Got a long
not much.
Let's take a look at the Brisbane and the Crows clash, and here it was. And it was a 6-point win to the visitors, and Aaron Phillips, 2 goals, 2, and as we said, 28 touches, 7 marks, 7 tackles. They got on the board early through Gibson, which was fantastic. Kelly Gibson in the first 20 seconds, if you don't mind. But that was just incredible, and it just set up the tone. It was a 40-metre goal from that angle. Unbelievable.
It was a huge goal, and as you said, it did set the tone for the rest of the match. Look, the Crows did a great job, and obviously they've come away with the premiership. They probably should have won by a little bit more. They did waste some opportunities up forward. They kicked six behinds in the second quarter and actually lost the second quarter. Yeah. But ultimately they go home with the premiership, and they'll be happy with that.
Frederick Traub there. She tried to ignite them in the third, and then obviously Taylor Harris, who was well held in the last, up until really the third and last quarter.
Yeah, Sabrina almost did get them over the line, Steph.
Yeah, she did. And you just mentioned Taylor Harris being well held. That was Chelsea Randall. Another sacrificial role for her as the co-captain of the football club. Put herself down on Harris and, you know, nullified her until late in the game. I think Taylor didn't have a stat until the third quarter. And Chelsea ended up with 16 disposals herself, as we can see here, launching an inside 50. And she's just a dynamic player. And if you don't mind, just a little handball through the legs coming up in the highlights reel.
Rose
her own ball.
Just wills herself to the contest and, like I said, sacrificial role. And, you know, assisted Erin Phillips and Noffy in the midfield to get them over the line.
Handball over the shoulder. What did you think, Nathan, that worked for the Crows?
I felt like the Crows midfield just dominated all day. You know, we've mentioned Phillips, but Marinoff and Cramie are a couple others that really stood up. You know, the clearances, the key statistics is clearances 29 to 11, contested possession 133 to 112, and inside 50s 43 to 27. Sort of alludes to what Ros was saying before, you know. I think Adelaide, you know, with that sort of dominance, could have won by a little bit more.
What do you think didn't work, Nathan?
Yeah, it's interesting. I think, you know, the Lions forwards were really well held. You know, I feel like we've touched on Chelsea Randall and that Taylor Harris matchup, but I felt like Angela Foley played a really important role. And Stevie Lee Thompson and versing Kate McCarthy was another significant one. I think Daisy mentioned in the commentary, you know, it was sort of that Lewis Jetta versus Cyril Rioli type matchup. And, you know, I think some really key roles and, you know, as Steph said before, some sacrificial roles. But I think, you know, the overall team defence really held up for Adelaide on the day.
Well, let's take a look at the best on ground and who it went to. It was none other than the co-captain, Erin Phillips. It was a fantastic performance by her. So we take a look at the results there. And she got the 11 votes to Chelsea Randall, 9. Emily Bates, Leah Kasler and Courtney Cramie.
Come on, Ros. Who's your vote for?
We're having a little bit of a giggle.
I don't know why she didn't get the full count.
Yeah, it was my vote. She obviously could have got 12, and I gave my 3 votes to Chelsea Randall. I think, as Steph mentioned, she played that sacrificial role. She kept Taylor Harris out of the game, and yep. I feel like if Chelsea Randall wasn't out on the field yesterday, Taylor would have had a huge impact and Brisbane would have won the game. So for that reason alone, Chelsea Randall was by far the best player on the ground for mine.
Well, here, in fact, is Chelsea Randall with, once again, Tom Wren.
Well, Tiff, what a brilliant game from this next star from the Crows. She was sensational all season, the co-captain, Chelsea Randall. Chelsea, what a magnificent win for the team.
I'm a bit speechless still. I'm just so incredibly proud of our girls and the way they went about their business today and really brought it home, and we were lucky enough to hold on there and bring that cup home.
And to turn it around as well, Chelsea, because they got you last time, so you had to do something differently, and you really did.
Yeah, Brisbane, look, they're a quality side and have had a fantastic season so far. And our girls, we had to bring a lot of energy, and we sure did that really well. And it was just, it's basically do or die. We just put everything out in the park. It was our last game of the season, and we just, you know, come away with the premiers. It's unreal.
And you wore Taylor Harris like a glove. It was such a fantastic matchup, but you just did not give her an inch today.
She was, you know, an incredible player, and I think I'll keep working on my kickouts as a backliner, because I think I made some mistakes there. But, you know, you live and learn, and look, yeah, a brilliant game.
And just finally, this season has been so good. It's captured the imagination of the public. Did you ever dream it would be as successful as it has been?
Oh, look, my dream was to play AFL, and round one, you know, that dream came true. And then it was, then now we're in a grand final, and it was like, wow, this is exciting. And now we're premiers, and, you know, that's just, you know, something you've never dreamed of. That's just incredible.
Well, Chelsea, you have been so brilliant for the game and a brilliant performance. You've got a premiership medallion. Congratulations, and thanks for joining us.
Awesome. Thanks, Tom.
Yeah, great job, Tom. And thanks so much to Chelsea Randall and Bec Goddard, our 2 guests so far on Women's Footy. And they don't go home empty-handed already, though they're already home. This is what they're going to expect in the mail, won't they, Ros? We'll be right back.
For joining us today, you'll receive a $200 voucher thanks to Maya, the Department of Stories. Shop in-store or online at maya.com.au. A $50 McCafe voucher thanks to McDonald's. Head in or drive through to taste their finest ever barista-made coffee. A pair of Boggs boots worth up to $149. Boggs footwear, comfortable footwear for uncomfortable conditions, whatever the weather. A $200 voucher from Hepburn Bathhouse and Spa. Unwind in luxury at Victoria's world-famous spa country. And a $250 voucher thanks to 2xU, the world's most advanced compression technology.
All right, let's take a look at our player of the year for Dress for Sale. They're not real estate agents. They're, oh my God, I want this home agents. And here we have it. Brianna Davey, the star defender from Carlton, 24 from Emily Bates from Brisbane. Daisy Pearce, obviously, we would have expected her probably up there in the top three, and Erin Phillips, top four, Chelsea Randall, top five. What are your thoughts on this?
Yeah, no surprises there, all stars of the game and, you know, well spread across all eight teams, which is fantastic to see. But Bree Davey, a clear standout for me, and considering she missed a game and a half with injury as well, it's a fantastic achievement.
Well, Ros, you're at the McCafe with two of our very special guests. Brianna will join us on the couch after the break, and don't forget to try to do McCafe's finest barista. There you go, Ros.
Thanks, Tiff, and I'm going to introduce another Tiff, Tiff Murray, the Managing Director from Dress for Sale, to hand over the award to Bree.
Okay, it's our absolute honour, Bree. Bree and I met in the green room. We love each other, and Dress for Sale are just so honoured to be part of this pioneering game. It's about bloody time, and let's hope next year it's 25,000. So congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Well deserved.
Thank you. Bree, tell me about your season. Obviously, you had a great season. You did have that back injury that kept you out, as Steph said, for a game and a half. How'd you rate your own performance across the 7 weeks?
Yeah, look, you know, it's a little bit disappointing to have gone down with a back injury, but at the same time, sort of count myself a little bit lucky. There's been girls who, unfortunately, you know, sustained injuries that are going to be long-term. But, you know, apart from that, I think, you know, I tried to... I guess be consistent across the season, and I think I, you know, managed to do that, and that was sort of my main goal for the season, to sort of play a role for my team and be as consistent as I could be.
And Carlton's performance over the season, obviously a bit up and down, but that draw against Brisbane in the final round must have been really pleasing and just reward against one of the stronger sides.
Yeah, definitely. Look, I think for us it was just wanting to sort of leave the season and make a mark, and you know, we weren't happy with a couple of our performances, and so we wanted to make sure that, you know, by the end of the season we weren't finishing, I guess, on a bit of a downer. So it was good to finish on a high note and to claw back against Brisbane.
And Tiff, tell us a bit about Dress for Sale and why you wanted to be involved in the AFLW inaugural season.
Okay, well, that's because we're trailblazers and groundbreakers as well. So we're a styling company that does pre-sale for the real estate industry. But we started in Adelaide. We're now in Melbourne. We'll be going to Sydney quite soon, so we're going to roll out nationally. We've done nearly 1,500 homes. But we do painting, flooring, electrical and everything, including hire furniture. So, yeah, like you, we're making our path around the country.
Well, we thank you very much for your support, and I'm sure Bree does too. $2,500 is nothing to sneeze at. I'm sure you can buy some great stuff with that. And Tiff, back to you.
Thank you so much, Ros. Thank you, Tiff, and thanks, Bree, who will be joining us after the break. So don't forget to try McCafe's finest barista-made coffee ever at any McCafe or McCafe drive-thru. As we head to the break, it's time for our final interview of the season in the plush comfort zone for Plush, Australia's choice for handcrafted comfort that is built to last. Plush, think sofas. Ros caught up with Debbie Lee, a pioneer of women's footy, having played over 300 games in the VWFL and a five-time league best and fairest. Debbie was on hand yesterday to present Crow Erin Phillips with her AFLW Women's Best on Ground medal. Let's meet this incredible trailblazer.
Deb, thanks for joining me in the Plush Comfort Zone today. You obviously have a long history with women's football. How proud are you to see a national competition finally get underway?
Yeah, it's just a great opportunity, isn't it? I mean, I've been involved with women's footy for a number of years, and it's just great that the AFL have provided a platform that these athletes can play and show the general community that they can play. Now they have the AFLW competition. Young girls can now see themselves in the sport, which is really important.
You're obviously a great footballer in your own right. You won 5 Helen Lambert medals as the VWFL Best and Fairest, and you were also All-Australian 5 times. How do you think you would have fared in today's game?
My football ability does not suit the game today, let's be honest. I wasn't quick, I could read the footy because I had the footy in my hands at a young age. And I guess, you know, I did like to tackle, but the game now is so quick.
Women's footy continues to have its detractors, of course. What's your message to those people who still don't believe in the game?
You know, it's great to have those knockers out there because, you know, we've had them all along. And now they're very few and far between. So, you know, the early days it was pretty challenging, but now it's great to see that the majority of people in the community and within the AFL and the sporting landscape are all behind it. And so they should be.
Deb, thanks for joining me in the plush comfort zone today.
Thanks, Ros.
Welcome back to our final episode of Women's Footy for Maya, the Department of Stories, and it gives me great pleasure now welcoming one of our very special guests, and she is Carlton's star defender, marquee player, Bree Davey. Welcome to the show.
No, thanks for having
me. I want to ask you, Carlton finished fourth, 3-3-1, so finished on a great note, obviously just couldn't quite get over the line against the Lions, but how would you rate Carlton's season?
Yeah, look, I think, you know, there was a couple of results in there that didn't quite go our way, but at the end of the day, I think we've learnt a lot from the season and, you know, we've got quite a youthful team. So yeah. I think going forward and with a bit of experience under their belts now, I think we've got a really promising future ahead.
Could you ever have imagined that, you know, the AFL women's comp could be this big?
Yeah, I mean, look, to be honest, initially I was a little bit sceptical and I think a lot of people were. I think it wasn't just myself, but now that it's happened, you know, it definitely exceeded expectations and it's absolutely incredible what the AFL have done with it and how smart they've put it together. So, yeah, you know, credit goes to the AFL and all the people who have worked to get this up and going.
Credit to you guys.
Absolutely. And obviously, Breezy, you played as a Matilda as a goalkeeper. So coming from an elite background in soccer, I think we've got some footage of it here. Played for Melbourne Victory and Melbourne City. Transitioned so seamlessly into AFL. Tell me about how you got scouted for soccer. I hear you were 11 years old on a family holiday and a scout saw you. What were you doing at the time?
Yeah, they used to have the annual Caravan Park playoffs.
Where was this?
This was at Anglesey Caravan Park up the coast. So, yeah, we used to have all the kids would sort of meet on the oval from everywhere. Everyone was allowed to play and being quite boisterous and quite sporty, I decided to jump on the field with all of the boys. And at the time, there was a scout there who his son was having a bit of a kick around as well. And he just said, oh, look, you know, we think you need to take this sport up. And at the time, I was sort of looking for a bit of a code switch because I grew up playing AFL but sort of saw that there was no pathway. Yeah. So, yeah, soccer was the next best thing at the time.
And obviously, having been a part of, you know, switching codes a couple of times, as you alluded to just then, and we've got a handful of girls that have done so this year in the AFLW competition. What have you found has made your transition successful in terms of, you know, the transferable skills from sport to sport?
Yeah, look, I think obviously with each sport it's going to be a little bit different what skills you take across, but I know there's been a couple of basketballs, like you've got Erin Phillips there, you've got Elle Downey, who I play with, she's my teammate, and, you know, being on a basketball court, you compare it to a footy oval and there's a massive difference. So I think the basketballers are really good at getting into tight spaces and being really composed under pressure because that's just what they're used to. So I think, you know, and then obviously as well, girls who have played at an elite level have sort of brought that across and I guess given experience to girls who haven't quite experienced that yet. So.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Well, stick with us. We want to pick your brains a little bit more. It's now time to take a look at our final NAB More Than Money story, focusing on Carlton midfielder and, of course, Bree's teammate, Shay Audley. Shay is a primary school teacher in the northeast of Melbourne, balancing the demands of a classroom full of six-year-olds with her commitments with the Blues. Let's take a look.
My name's Shay Audley. I teach grade ones at Lorimer Primary School, which is out near Yarrambat, and I play for the Carlton Football Club. So I used to go down every week and watch my brother play at Hurstbridge Football Club, and I guess I just loved the physicality of the way he played, and I thought, well, if he's doing it, I was kind of like, anything he can do, I can do as well. When I got to the end of under 13s, I was told that I couldn't play anymore. I was absolutely devastated that I couldn't go out and play the game that I loved, and I still trained with the boys every week and I was actually their runner for the next 3 years, and then when they went into seniors I became their water girl. I chose teaching as a career, I guess, because I saw that I could give something back to the kids, exactly like the way my teachers did for me. I've got 21 little kids in my grade and they're absolutely beautiful. They come in and tell me every Monday morning that they've seen Miss Audley playing on the TV, and I guess I share a little bit of my successes with them too. When we get a win, I say that I've got a celebration for the week, and so I can give a little bit back to them as well through my experiences, which hopefully help them achieve their dreams as well. To say that I'm playing in the first women's national competition is just amazing. I wouldn't have thought that even 5 years ago, 2 years ago, I wouldn't have thought that this opportunity would be available to me, and now that it is, I guess it's very surreal. Like, I tried to take in how many people were in the crowd on the first game and what that atmosphere was like, and it just, I literally had to pinch myself, like people say that, but I had to pinch myself at the fact that it wasn't a dream and I was living out what is now reality. Is just amazing.
And Brie, I want to ask you, does she act like a school teacher around the club rooms?
Oh, Shay, she's hilarious. She's actually probably one of my favourite people to be around. She's very a big personality, so I think she probably acts a little bit different at school. But no, she's awesome. She's great to have around, Shay.
And told by her mum to never give up on her dream, look where she is now. Well, it's now time for the final of the season. It's time for my favourite part of the show, cherry picked thanks to 2xU, the world's most advanced compression technology. And guys, we're pleased to announce our overall winners, and it's Elise Strawn from the Melbourne Football Club. This is amazing how she does this. She bounces footballs like basketballs and then straight through. So she can do just about everything. So she wins a $500 voucher thanks to 2xU, and she's our professional winner. And here is our amateur winner, which is Alex Salter from the Great Britain Swans. Yeah. I can get that out. A bit of David Beckham-esque.
Yeah, it's unreal.
Good is... Can you do that,
no.
Nate?
Oh, Steph, not quite.
Brie?
Certainly not, but she's wearing a really good number, so good on her. Good pick up.
All right, and we've got a winner, of course, from a punter who's picked one of their favourite winners of the week, and it comes to Rob Murphy from Bendigo. So it's actually not Robert Murphy.
Not the skipper.
The skipper of the Bulldogs. But he wins himself a $1,000 2xU package.
Great support from 2xU over the whole course of the season. So everyone got involved. It was a really good competition and great to see some top award winners.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. All the best for next season and your back injury.
Thank you.
Recovering from that. We're going to take a break and we'll be back with more women's footy right after this. Back to Women's Footy for Maya, the Department of Stories, and our comprehensive review of the AFLW Grand Final. And I want to say, ask the two of you, after 2 months, how do you build a successful premiership side? What do you think?
It's an interesting discussion, really. You know, we've probably come up with a rough formula, you know, one key forward, a couple of consistent key midfielders. The marshalling defender is very important, I think, and, you know, obviously overall positional depth to cover for, you know, any injuries that may pop up through a season. It's an interesting question I wanted to ask Steph, a ruckman. I think the importance in the AFL is quite significant on a ruck. What are your thoughts on a ruckman?
Yeah, well, coming from a Collingwood perspective, we've got Emma King, who had 199 tap-outs for the season and, you know, fed our midfielder. So I think a ruckman's crucial to a winning formula. And you saw the ruck women yesterday for Adelaide. Mm. You know, they had two, Metcalf and Allen, rotating through there, who dominated for the Crows. So, yeah, definitely a pivotal part of an AFLW team.
So there you have it. For any prospective coaches out there, there's a few tips from a couple of our champions. All right, time now for our Recruit of the Week for Victoria Police to be part of a team that makes our community safer. Be a force for good. And after 7 weeks of nominees, we're set to announce our Victoria Police Recruit of the Year. But before we do, let's head to Ros at Armour Cafe, who has 2 very special guests.
I've got 3 very special guests, actually, Tiff. I'll first introduce Victoria Police Chief Commissioner Graham Ashton and Superintendent Lisa Hardiman. First of all, thank you for coming in. Graham, I'll hand over to you to present the cheque for this award.
Great, thanks. Well, certainly on behalf of Victoria Police, it's great to be here today, and certainly great to be here to present the award for Recruit of the Year to Emma, and just to congratulate you, Emma, on a fantastic season. Well done.
Thank you very much.
Great stuff. And Emma, you had a remarkable season at the Bulldogs. Bulldogs. Just a great year. Obviously, the Bulldog season overall didn't go as well as you would have hoped, but how did you rate your own performances across the year?
Yeah, I thought my season as a whole was quite consistent, I think. It really helps playing with Ali Blackburn in the midfield. We play at Melbourne Uni together, so I think when you have that chemistry already, it really helps. Yeah, but as you said, like, it was a pretty disappointing year as a team. Probably just didn't play as consistently as we would have hoped.
You're another cross-code athlete. We had Bree on earlier, yeah, of course. Your cricketing background. Tell me how those skills helped or hindered you moving across to football, and I guess at a critical time of year for cricket as well, your pre-season would have been interrupted by your cricket season.
Yeah, I suppose with cricket you still need to have a really good fitness base. So for me, I'm sort of always in pre-season, so my fitness is always being worked on, so that certainly helps. And obviously with the hand-eye coordination, that sort of stuff, ball handling is really helpful in cricket. But yeah, as you said, my pre-season for football was very interrupted. I think I missed 10 sessions just because I was playing in the Big Bash. So look, it did affect me a little bit, but yeah, I really enjoyed the season.
Graham, tell me a bit about the Victoria Police recruitment campaign, which is happening at the moment.
Yeah, well, it's been great to sponsor this award because it's all about recruits and best recruits, and we're after the best recruits for Victoria Police at the moment. We're on a big recruiting campaign, and we're really trying to encourage women to get involved with Victoria Police and consider a career in policing, because it's a great career. As I'm sure Lisa would attest, it's a career that offers lots of options and very a wide variety of types of things you can do in the police. So for women watching, especially young women thinking about the career ahead, have a think about policing because it is a great career.
And Lisa, obviously you've had a long background in women's footy and policing as well. Tell us a bit about your background in women's footy, where it all started for you.
I started playing in 1988 with a friend of mine answering that in the newspaper. I actually didn't know there was a league. From 1988 I became a player, state player, coach, state coach and president, which is where women's football really started to grow. So I've had a very extensive background with women's football.
And the Hampson Honeyman Cup, of course, is named after you. We won't forget that.
So the Hampson Honeyman Cup, that came about. Barb Hanson was the president of WA at the time, and I was the president of Victoria. And we actually got together and started the first interstate competition. And so we're both really honoured when the AFL named the cup in honour of Barb and myself and our pioneering days, I suppose, for women's football, and that was handed out for the Melbourne versus Bulldog challenge games. So very much an honour.
Well, we thank you for your contribution to women's football, and we thank Victoria Police more broadly for their contribution to women's football this year in supporting this award, and congratulations to Emma.
Thanks very much.
Back to you, Tiff.
Thank you, Rosie, and well done. Well deserved. Average 21 touches for the season. Fantastic effort, Emma, and thank you to Graham and Lisa. And that was our recruit of the year for Victoria Police. Be a force for good. As we head to the break, let's take a look at our final high performance matchup for Victoria University. As leaders in sport, VU will provide you with access to the best sporting team facilities in the Southern Hemisphere. And this week, it's Melbourne's midfielder Karen Paxman and Western Bulldogs defender Bailey Hunt going head to head in combined testing. Here they are.
Hi, I'm Karen Paxman and I play for the Melbourne Football Club.
Hi, I'm Bailey Hunt and I play for the Western Bulldogs.
And we're here today at Victoria University for the high performance matchup
to do some draft combine testing.
So today we did the 20 metre sprint, the 6 times 30 metre repeat sprint test and a standing vertical jump. What we get from this is just a basic physical understanding of where they're at. We can use it to provide programs for them to try and improve some of their weaknesses.
I think testing's always, it brings a little bit of nervous energy. Yeah, it was interesting, I guess, to put some, I guess, data to your work rate, and I've never really done any kind of testing like this before, so it's kind of nice to see where you're at.
I suppose the sprint testing helped with footy because, you know, it works on your technique. And vertical jump, you know, being in the back line, I want to be able to jump up and spoil, you know, be higher than everyone else so that you can't let a forward mark. Nice way to wake up in the morning.
For all tests, Karen actually was slightly better across all performances. She is better at being able to sprint and accelerate off the mark. She's also better at being able to repeatedly do that over and over again in a game situation. And she has a little bit better leg power. So in a marking contest, she would be able to get her hands up higher compared to Bailey.
I do have a competitive nature, and I think most of the girls do. And I think you have to have it to improve and stay competitive amongst everyone else. And I guess ultimately get to where you want to be with your goals and all that sort of stuff. So yeah, Bailey did really well anyway today.
I'd like to think so, but we've put me up against PAX, one of the gut runners of the competition, then it changes a bit, you know.
I really hope to see in better data so we have a greater understanding about what it takes physically to be a female footballer and where we can target certain areas.
Welcome back to Women's Footy. Let's now take a look at our NAB AFL Women's Rising Star competition. NAB proudly supporting every footballer's dreams from NAB AFL Auskick through the NAB AFL Women's Rising Star all the way to the big time. And our round seven nominees are Deanna Berry from Melbourne and Nicola Barn. We caught up with Nicola through the week to have a chat about her footy career.
Yeah, it's really nice to know that I guess all your hard work throughout the season pays off, and I've been really lucky to have some amazing teammates around me who've really helped me develop and grow throughout the season. I love that it's so raw, you know, the girls are just playing it because they absolutely love the game, and there's no other reason that they're playing except for that, and I think that that's amazing and it's really unique to the competition. I think Alicia Eva is really cool from Collingwood. She's just so passionate about the game, and she's really quick and uses her speed, and yeah, I really admire that. Definitely Alex Saundry. She is constantly on her phone because she thinks she's a top dog. My favourite thing to do away from footy would be to ride my push bike around. I love using my bike to get from place to place, and yeah, I love doing that with my friends.
And the number one draft pick from last year's draft. Well done to Nicola and GWS. Now to celebrate the launch of the TAC Cup Girls competition, which is in its second week, our good friends at Myer took two up-and-coming footy stars for a shopping experience at Myer Doncaster, hosted by their stylist and brand experts. Let's check them out.
Hi, I'm Neve O'Connor and I'm from Northern Knights.
Hi, I'm Georgia Borg and I'm from Eastern Rangers.
And we're at Myer Doncaster, we're going to find some new outfits.
Let's go.
I did athletics since I was 7 years old and I quit last year. I realised I'm more suited to a team sport and I really love the team environment better.
I actually did trampolining for 2 years and basketball and dancing and cricket for a season, which I didn't enjoy too much, but I basically did every other sport besides football, and then I got started and I haven't looked back ever since.
Hey girls, how you going?
Good, thanks.
My name's Laura. I'm the Piper Master Brands expert here at Doncaster. Is there anything you guys wanted me to help you with? So I'm a Piper brand expert at Myer Doncaster, which basically means that I know the range inside out and I just get to really focus on that brand in the store. So the Piper range is not specifically for an age group as such, but it's more about effortlessly stylish. So on-trend pieces, really good for weekend events, that sort of thing, like brunch with your friends.
I play ruck and I really like that position. I like the physicality and the intensity and the fast pace of the game, really.
I have two older brothers and I've always been around, you know, bumping and tackling. So when I started that, it was just my element and I loved it. My grandparents are very worried about me getting hurt. So whenever I get injured, they always call up and like, just stop playing football, you'll stop getting injured. But I love it. They love me playing it and they love it. I love it. So it's really good. My football dream's to play AFL, and basically that's all I've ever wanted.
I'd love to play AFL one day. I think the girls out there are a huge inspiration and they've inspired all the other girls out there playing footy, so it's really good. Everyone should jump on board.
Hi Isabella, could you please get me a sign?
I do love being in my footy gear. Also do like to dress up and look nice every once in a while.
I love working at Myer because I get to style customers every day and pick that perfect outfit for them, and they feel fabulous.
I think it's a fun job. It's really nice to engage with people, and because I know the Piper range so well, it means that if someone has something specific in mind, I can find something for them, really nail that outfit.
It was really great having a styling session with the change room consultants today.
I had so much fun today. I picked up a couple of really nice things and I've been actually really happy with the experience.
Everyone loves being treated like a superstar, and Maya has certainly done that for us. Big thank you for all their support. Now, as we take a break, it's time for our very last My Fitness Challenge for Genesis, a fitness club for everybody. Good things come to those who sweat. Visit genesisfitness.com.au. This week, it's Western Bulldogs young recruit Bec Neves pumping some iron in the gym.
Hi, I'm Bec Neves from the Western Bulldogs, and we're here at Genesis doing the My Fitness Challenge, and we're going to do some resistance weights. Come with us. I grew up in Victoria, and then when I was about 9, moved to New South Wales and started playing footy there with the boys. I was the only girl. Family moved back down to Victoria, played basketball, played rugby sevens last year, did the AFL talent search, and they recommended me to go to a BFL club. So I went down to St Kilda Sharks and, yeah, had a good season with them. It was pretty fun. Good to be back. It was a big challenge, but I was very excited. Like, the hype around women's footy was really growing at that stage and everyone was talking about the AFL. And it was challenging to keep up and get my skills back because I've had so long off. The girls down there really helped me.
So today we took them through some movements, being deadlift, our squats and also bench press. Strength training is important for everyone. It helps strengthen the body, prime them for movement, and also assist with weight loss as well.
It's really helpful for us because we need the power in our legs and arms to push off defenders, help us mark, and get the leash going.
Before we say goodbye on Women's Footy, a big thank you to Jaylene over at Armit Cafe, who's been serving up some fantastic coffees all season. So thank you very much. And as I said before we go, I want to get your tips on who's going to win the league best and fairest and Tuesday night's W award.
I think Erin Phillips for mine, goal-kicking midfielder, dynamic.
I've got to go with the Demon. It's got to either be Paxi or Daisy. They'll probably both steal votes off each other, but one of them.
I think Bree Davey, because I don't think many other players at Carlton will poll well, so I think she'll get some votes.
Well, thank you so much. That is a wrap on Women's Footy. To our panellists, you've been fantastic on behalf of Ros and I, to everyone, Croc Media, Channel 9, everyone behind the scenes, and to Chelsea Randall and to the Adelaide Crows, we salute you.